Like all good comedy, the character of Pat from Saturday Night Live, played by actress Julia Sweeney, tells us something very revealing. That our ability to recognize someone as either male or female is absolutely fundamental to our ability to interact with them. And that there is nothing natural about that recognition. It's dependent upon certain signals being communicated that allow us to position people in categories, male, female, that make sense to us. If we can't properly understand or properly read those signals, or if they're not being sent out in ways we can understand, then it is almost impossible to proceed to any further social interaction. And so those people who present themselves as androgynous, i.e. as not fitting cleanly into the typical masculine and feminine gender roles of their society, pose a challenge to a cultural system that is dependent upon those categories being clear. In fact, if this clarity is not achieved, then everything seems to fall apart.
What the hell are you doing in here, boy? Can't you read this is the ladies' room? Get the out!
I'm a girl.
You see that freak there? It was just in the girls' bathroom.
You must be a faggot.
Faggot.
Faggot!
Hey, faggot!
What did you say?
Just let it go, Jenny.
Johnny, you're crazy!
I called you a faggot.
Look, man, we don't want any trouble, okay?
No, I don't want any trouble either. Food. Just want to get on top. We're on top.
Look, we're out of here, all right? Dude, leave us alone.
You faggot. Get out of this!
Stop it!
No, take it back!
So, if we want to fit in and function normally, we have to learn both how to send out the right signals and how to read the signals that are being sent out by others.
Not since the end of World War II, at the height of the baby boom, have there been so many kids in our midst. There are now more than 52 million kids under 12 in all in the United States, the biggest burst in the U.S. youth population in half a century. And for American business, these kids have come to represent the ultimate prize. An unprecedented, powerful, and elusive new demographic to be cut up and captured at all costs. There's no doubt that marketers have their sights on kids because of their increasing buying power, the amount of money they now spend on everything from clothes to music to electronics, totaling some $40 billion every year. But perhaps a bigger reason for marketers' interest in kids may be the amount of adult spending that American kids under 12 now directly influence, an astronomical $700 billion a year, roughly the equivalent of the combined economies of the world's 115 poorest countries.
One economic impact of children is the money that they themselves spend. The money that they get from their parents or grandparents, the money that they get as allowance when they get older, the money that they earn themselves. That is an increasingly significant amount of money. But that's not where the real money is. Marketers and advertisers have realized that the real money related to the children's market is in their purchasing influence.
Any questions? Jared, does it do any tricks?
Because of their purchasing power and because of their purchasing influence, marketers and advertisers have become much more deliberate in their strategies and attempts to how to influence those dollars.
Sienna, because kids come first.
It's the children who often determine what kind of car gets bought, what kind of computer gets bought, what kind of cell phone program, and even where they take family holidays.
What's your favorite part of the Nick Hotel?
The awesome pools.
Having my own room.
The arcade rocks.
I like the shops.
I like eating with SpongeBob.
They came on vacation and the kids don't ever want to leave.
Most parents and other people just don't realize how corporate marketers intentionally try to, well, in essence, make parents absolutely miserable. Corporate marketers have actually studied the whole nagging phenomenon, which corporations do nagging better, and they provide advice to corporations about, you know, what kinds of tantrums work better.
Children sometimes say, you know, can I, as much as 9 times.
Will you take us to Mount Splashmore? Will you take us to Mount Splashmore?
No!
And part of the nag factor is designed to help maximize the number of times children will keep asking and keep asking.
No!
Will you take us to Mount Splashmore?
If I take you, will you two shut up and quit bugging me?
Yeah, of course. Well, will you take us to Mount Splashmore?
Yes!
Thanks, Dad.
So these kids have a lot of power in the economy. The advertisers know it, and they are going after them in a way that is unprecedented.
If we were to look at advertising as telling us something about modern America, we'd have to presume that normality has taken a holiday. This is a world where normal social and physical arrangements simply do not hold. Winter turns into summer. A simple shampoo brings intense sexual pleasure. Spells are cast by love potions and perfumes. Futuristic suburban daughters return home from an intergalactic date, wearing eye-popping jeans from another planet. Ballpoint pens wearing sunglasses leer at inviting bikini-clad women. Things offer instant access to the world of desire, eroticism, and sometimes even love. Nerdy young men on the beach, through the wonders of video rewind, can constantly call up beautiful women walking by. An entire and intense experience of a lifetime is encapsulated in the gaze across an elevator. Old women become magically young, offering both sex and beer to young men. If an anthropologist from Mars was to look at the society where these messages were everywhere, they'd conclude that this society is dominated by a belief in magic. The cultural theorist Rowan Williams, one of the first people who paid careful attention to advertising, actually called it the magic system, where goods were held to have incredible power. In fact, what goods promise in advertising is immense. They can capture qualities of the natural world. They can perform feats of bewitchment and transformation.
Hey, Billy, you free tonight?
They can bring instant happiness and gratification. They act as a passport into a world of a fantasy and desire.
I knew you'd get it.
Must be from heaven.
Close.
Some products can even capture Lady Luck in the flesh. So an anthropologist most probably would see a similarity to older traditions and beliefs around notions of magic and objects. If we asked an economist to look at contemporary society, they would most probably see our differences from what appeared before industrial society. Industrial capitalism is a very different type of society than the agricultural feudalism that preceded it, just in terms of the number of objects that are produced. An economist then would point to the quantitative dimension in looking at the differences, the number of things that are present in everyday life, the number of things that capitalism can produce. One economist actually says that what distinguishes capitalism from what came before is its ability to produce an immense accumulation of commodities. In fact, no other society in history has been able to match the immense productive output of capitalism. And this fact, capitalism's productivity, this fact can be seen everywhere in the daily landscape of life. Objects are everywhere in the daily lives that we all live. In that sense, capitalism is truly a revolutionary society, dramatically altering the landscape of social life in a short time like no other society before had been able to manage. Now, of course, once the immense accumulation of commodities are produced, they must also be sold. You can't just produce things and not sell them. For commodities to lead to profits for producers, they have to go through the circuit of production, distribution, and consumption. The problem for capitalism is how do you convert the investment in goods back into money and into profit. The problem of capitalism is not production, but actually is the problem of consumption. And so central is the consuming element of the society, that capitalism invents a new industry to deal with the consumption of commodities. At the end of the 19th century, it invents the advertising industry. The function of the advertising industry would be to recruit the best creative talent of the society and to create a culture in which desire and identity would be fused with commodities. In fact, to make the dead world of things come alive with human and social possibilities.
Here it comes! And frightening! Here! And the rough tails! Show it to the mother. That's enough. Right, sedate her. Number the child. There you go.
A boy or a girl?
Now, I think it's a little early to start imposing roles on it, don't you?
Goffman argues that there is nothing natural about gender identity. That is, we don't just pop out of the womb with our gender identities imprinted in our genes. That it is part of a process whereby we learn to take on certain attributes that we think are appropriate to our understanding of ourselves in gender terms. Therefore, we have to analyze how the society constructs the categories within which we fit. And to understand how that takes place, we have to first make a distinction between the terms sex and gender. Sex refers to our different biological characteristics as we come out of the womb. Gender refers to the way those differences are made sense of within culture. In most cultures, by assigning it to one of two categories, male or female. And then each of those categories is further defined with a set of characteristics that seem to be mutually exclusive that are labeled as masculine and feminine. This does not mean that everything is about culture. The point is that while we are born with a set of different individual physical and biological characteristics, these traits are then made sense of through the categories of culture. In this way, there is nothing natural or biological about gender or our gender identities. We learn to inhabit the gender category that we have been assigned from outside, from the culture. There are some interesting cases where individuals born as one sex have been assigned to the wrong gender category. That is, someone born with male physical characteristics but assigned to the female gender. And they then grow up as that gender despite the physical sexual origin. And there are some cultures that actually recognize a third sex or a middle sex with its own set of gender characteristics. For example, in the culture of the Indian subcontinent, there's a whole class of people who are called Hijra, who are neither male nor female, but a third intersex category. They have a recognized and legitimate role to play in the society, and it is estimated that they number close to 1 million people. If nothing else, these examples show that our ideas and attitudes about gender are shaped by the culture and society we grow up in. But while potentially, and in actual real life, there could be many different categories of genders, Western culture mostly operates with a two-sex, two-gender distinction.
Advertising to kids may have been confined during the 70s, but it was during this period that it would come into its own as an industry, triggering a counter-movement to end youth marketing altogether, and setting in motion a series of policy decisions that would ultimately determine the industry's future.
A seminal event was in the late 70s when the Federal Trade Commission advocated a ban on advertising to children 8 and under.
The Federal Trade Commission staff believes that children are deceived by television advertising, particularly commercials for cereal with sugar in it, and it wants to stop all advertising aimed at young children.
This ban was based in part on concern about sugar cereals and cavities, and also based on research that indicated that children 8 and under did not understand the persuasive intent of advertising.
Are you saying that every message directed to the older child, a child between 8 and 12, is inherently deceptive?
That's right. I think the child cannot bring enough information to bear not to be deceived and to have an unfair trade practice.
So what ended up happening was the industries that were going to be affected, the toy industries, the sugar cereal companies, went to Congress.
And that in an American democratic capitalistic society, we almost learn top to bottom to care for ourselves. And what the last thing we need in the next 20 years is a national nanny.
And Congress ended up taking away a lot of the FTC's authority to regulate marketing to children.
Far from addressing consumer advocates' concerns about the impact of advertising on kids, in 1980, Congress passed the FTC Improvement Act. The law mandated that the FTC would no longer have any authority to promulgate any rules regarding children's advertising.
The Congress of the United States, under pressure from advertisers and marketers, actually took away from the Federal Trade Commission the right, the authority to regulate advertising and marketing to children.
And what little remained of government's power to regulate children's advertising would be dealt a final, fatal blow in the early 1980s.
Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
In the 1980s, this country was in a situation of falling in love with the market, thinking that the market was the solution to everything, and of deregulating industry.
For those of you with television stations, I have an announcement. As you know, I've never liked big government, and I think you will agree there's no reason to substitute the judgment of Washington bureaucrats for that of professional broadcasters.
By 1984, the Reagan administration had completely deregulated children's television.
You know, our media systems are dominated by advertising. If you look at television and radio, 100% of their revenues come from advertisers. If you look at magazines, the ratio is about 50% from advertisers, 50% from customers. If you look at newspapers, the ratio is about 80-20 in favor of advertising. So what we've done, we've turned our media systems into vehicles for selling products. And you simply cannot understand media content without understanding its relationship to advertising.
See that Coke can on top of the alien craft? Think you can shoot that thing off? Do it, shoot it.
The movies have been turned over to advertisers who, through product placement, reach captive audiences. You can't zap an ad in the middle of a movie in a theater. The prime function of many Hollywood films now is to sell commodities, not tell a story. For example, in GoldenEye, James Bond for the first time drives a non-British car, a BMW. He seduces with Bollinger champagne, listens to Alpine car stereo, flies British Airways, and uses IBM computers. More and more, movies are tied in with other advertising campaigns.
Really, Dublin, so you should use a Visa check card. It automatically deducts from your checking account everywhere Visa's accepted.
See, tomorrow never dies.
Professional sports, you know, are no longer independent. They were at one time, but nowadays they are totally integrated into the marketing effort. A good example of this, if you wanted to see it, would be to look at baseball and how the ads behind home plate, you know, have colonized spaces that at one time were free of commercial influence. Even those institutions thought to be outside of the market are being sucked in. Schools now are selling their students to advertisers, and commercials flood classrooms, school buses, and school hallways and cafeterias. Advertisers have deeply penetrated into public education. New technologies are swallowed up by this. The internet, it was thought, would be outside of the commercial mix, but it is now fully integrated into the advertising system. In the modern world, everything now is sponsored by someone. The latest plans even involve the commercialization of the sky.
In April was to launch a rocket, send it 200 miles into orbit, deploy a Mylar billboard, and inflate it with compressed gas. The Mylar billboard would measure about two-thirds of a mile across and a quarter mile tall. From Earth, it might appear about half the size of the moon, the company originally said, and envisioned charging $20 to $30 million to whatever corporation might care to buy space.
Our culture has simply become an adjunct to the system of production and consumption. Its job is to sell us things. And as it does that, it impacts how we think about the world and ourselves.
First, the neatness of this distinction has functioned to downplay similarities between the sexes. That is, the things that men and women have in common as human beings, in favor of highlighting their differences. And second, This distinction downplays the variability within each sex. It papers over the differences between men, between different ways of being a man, as well as the differences between women and different ways of being a woman. So that it is presented that there is only one dominant and normal way in which to be feminine, and only one dominant and normal way to be masculine. And what Goffman is interested in is how the two sex, two gender categories, these codes of normality, are created and, more importantly, maintained and held in place. That is one of the main things that Goffman wants to accomplish, to make visible what seems to be invisible, or at least below our level of conscious perception. And while he's really a student of interpersonal behavior, that is the way people talk and interact face to face, he thinks the best place to clearly see the codes is somewhere else, in the culture, in one of its most concentrated, exaggerated, and distilled forms, advertising, and by extension, other popular media. He actually calls advertising commercial realism. That is, it is trying to present the world in ways that could be real. And because advertising is usually operating in a context where audiences are quite resistant to being exposed to commercial intrusions, as well as being bombarded with messages from other advertisers, they need to communicate in a way that is quick and which is deep at the same time. And using the codes of gender display fulfills both those requirements. They reference a deep aspect of individual identity and can be communicated quickly at a glance because they're so familiar. So Goffman focuses on advertisements not so much because of their impact or effect on us, not because of how they make us act or what they make us buy, but because of what their seeming normality tells us about ourselves. In fact, Goffman says that perhaps the most negative thing that we can say about these gender displays in ads is that they do not look strange to us. That is, as depictions of reality, they do not look peculiar or weird. They actually look kind of normal. It is only when we start to look at them carefully that we begin to see how strange and weird they actually are, and begin the process of thinking independently for ourselves about what the culture holds up as normal. In this way, according to Goffman, to see one of the deepest aspects of our identities, we have to go outside ourselves to the messages that surround us. We have to become, in a way, visual anthropologists, looking at a world that seems very familiar and natural, advertising, in a way that provides some analytical distance from it. If we can do that, deconstruct the smallest details of the commercial environment that envelops us with the same meticulous care and attention to detail that their makers put into creating them, then we may be able to see ourselves in a new light.
The Walt Disney Company has been a powerful force in creating childhood culture all over the world. Disney's massive success is based on images of innocence, magic, and fun. Its animated films in particular are praised as wholesome family entertainment, endorsed by teachers and parents, and immensely popular with children.
Well, I think that Disney is really a very, very important part of American culture in terms of its identity. If you can imagine for a moment that children, in fact, have been raised on Disney for many generations now, that they've seen Mickey Mouse, all of these icons of Walt Disney have been part of their life since they were children.
I think of very like fond memories and very good things because, I mean, I remember going to the movies with my best friend when I was like 7 and my grandmother, and it was, and watching it with my mom, and it had a lot to do with family and like people who I loved, and I guess it was, I don't know, a very salient aspect of my childhood.
The first time I probably saw a Disney movie was probably before I could talk, because my mother has a huge love of Disney as well.
It's entertainment, and that it's enjoyable to watch, and
for some reason people love to buy t-shirts and stuffed animals, and you know, it's just, it's magic.
You wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything.
I think that one of the things that's so interesting about Disney as compared to other corporations is that Disney has made a spectacle of innocence. I mean, it hides behind innocence in a way that allows it to separate corporate culture from corporate power. And it has a kind of romance about it that allows us in some way to treat Disney as the ultimate form of fantasy, a fantasy that never needs to be questioned.
Disney is a transnational media conglomerate, owning TV and radio networks, cable systems, internet sites, music studios, media production companies, magazines, sports teams, theaters, and theme parks. As a result, Disney exerts a tremendous influence on national and international popular culture.
The way the media influences the way we think is much less immediate and much less a sort of straightforward impact on the way we think. And it's much more a question of creating a certain environment of images that we grow up in and that we become used to. And after a while, those images will begin to shape what we know and what we understand about the world. And that's not an immediate kind of whiz-bang effect. That's a slow, accumulative effect, and it's much more subtle.
Don't love me, Captain!
Come run the hidden pine trails of the forest. Come taste the sun-sweet fairies of the earth. Come roll in all the riches all around you. And for once, never wonder what they were.
Encoded in media images are ideologies about how we think about the world, belief systems, constructions of reality, and we develop our notions of reality from the cultural mechanisms around us. And one of the most important cultural institutions that we have today is indeed the media. It gives us a whole array of images, of stereotypes, of belief systems about race, about class, about gender. And we now live in a media-based system where most of our leisure time is spent consuming media. And so it's really important to analyze the institution of media in order to understand how we, as consumers and as citizens, understand the media and the role the media plays in socializing us into certain belief systems.
Ta-da! And of course you know that we're so beautiful. We have the prettiest one, huh? See me, John.
Let's start with your bread and butter. The support behind the rites of passage. The diamond engagement ring, diamond anniversary band, and the 25th anniversary diamond. Our goal is to make diamonds a cultural imperative for all these important occasions in a woman's life. That's why we are continuing to support these segments so that newer products like the Diamond Anniversary Band and the 25th Anniversary Diamond will become as obligatory as the Diamond Engagement Ring, bringing your customers back again and again. That's what we're here for, to respond to your requests and to help you sell more diamonds.
In that sense, commercial culture is now inside our intimate relationships. It is inside our homes, inside our heads, inside our identities. So overwhelming has the commercial takeover of culture become that it has now become a problem for advertisers who now worry about clutter and noise. That is, how do you make your ad stand out from the 3,600 commercial impressions that people are exposed to? So if you're Pepsi, you're not just competing with Coke anymore, but you're competing with every other advertiser who wants our attention. As advertising takes over more and more space in the culture, the job of the individual advertiser gets harder and harder. So more care and thought goes into the ads than any other type of message, much more so than the programs that you see on television. In fact, network ads can cost anywhere from a few hundred thousand dollars to millions of dollars to make.
We decided to do it on location in a lot in Israel
on the Red Sea. We hired a director in London and some set builders from the London Theater District who built a watch approximately the size of a two-story colonial home. And we choreographed it from a yacht that we had specially equipped so that we could see them underwater. And in a day's time, we would get about 4 or 5 seconds of film. It took us about 2 weeks to film it.
Ads, actually, if you wanted to compare them with anything, ads are made like big Hollywood blockbusters. That's how much money is expended on them. That's how much care goes into them. If you strung together an hour and a half of TV ads, they would cost more than the biggest Hollywood film. So the influence of advertising in that sense is immense. If we normally pay a lot of attention to these big Hollywood films that come out every summer. But if we think about the time and effort that goes into them as going into all the advertising that we see, that we are exposed to, I think the influence of advertising at that point, you know, becomes pretty immense.
God has spoken!
Who are you?
Oh, I am the great and powerful Wizard of Oz.
You're a very bad man.
Oh, no, my dear. I'm a very good man. I'm just a very bad wizard.
The climactic scene where Toto pulls back the curtain to reveal a nervous, tragic man pretending to be the great and powerful Oz represents more than just a classic moment in American cinematic history. Rather, it also gave us a metaphor for looking at masculinity in a new way, not as a fixed, inevitable state of being, but rather as a projection, a pose, a guise, an act, a mask that men often wear to shield our vulnerability and hide our humanity. This mask can take a lot of forms, but one that's really important to look at in our culture at the millennium is what I call the tough guise, the front that so many men put up that's based on an extreme notion of masculinity that emphasizes toughness and physical strength and gaining the respect and admiration of others through violence or the implicit threat of it. Boys and young men learn early on that being a so-called real man means you have to take on this tough guise. In other words, you have to show the world only certain parts of yourself that the dominant culture has defined as manly. You can find out what those qualities are if you just listen to young men themselves.
A real man is physical.
Strong. Independent.
He's powerful.
Physical.
Intimidating.
Strong.
Independent.
In control.
Rugged.
Scares people.
Powerful.
Respected.
Hard.
A stud. Athletic.
He's muscular.
A real man is tough.
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 And just as most young men know what our culture expects of a so-called real man, they also know very well what you get called if you don't measure up.
You get called a pussy, a bitch.
He's a fag.
Queer.
Soft.
You're a little mama's boy.
Emotional.
Girly.
He's a wimp.
Bitch. Queer. You get called weak.
Wuss.
Sissy.
Fag.
A fag.
Fag.
You're a fag.
So for boys, and this is true for every racial and ethnic background and every socioeconomic group, to be a real man, to be tough, strong, independent, respected, means fitting into this narrow box that defines manhood. The terms that are the opposite of that, wuss, wimp, fag, sissy, are insults that are used to keep boys boxed in. So if you're a boy, it's pretty clear there's a lot of pressure on you to conform, to put up the act, to be just one of the guys. So the next question is, where do boys learn this? Obviously, they learn it in many different places. They learn from their families, their community. But one of the most important places they learn it is the powerful and pervasive media system, which provides a steady stream of images that define manhood as connected with dominance, power, and control.
With this idea that the body is a text, a means of communication, that body postures carry deeply significant meanings, we can get to the heart of Goffman's analysis, what he calls the ritualization of subordination, and of how female bodies in particular are used to demonstrate the broader social idea that what the culture defines as feminine has a subordinate relationship to what the culture defines as masculine. The starting point is his observation that women, with far greater frequency than men, are very often shown lying down in a recumbent position. And Goffman makes two important points about the significance of this pose. First, he says that in this position, it is difficult to defend yourself,
and that therefore you're dependent upon what he calls the benignness of the surround. That is, the reclining position that women are placed in gives them no defense against possible threats. It is a submissive and powerless position, utterly dependent on the world being risk and danger-free. And Goffman's point is relatively simple. This is a posture that communicates submission and powerlessness, and women are overwhelmingly featured utilizing it. In fact, Goffman's suggestion that we imagine a man in these body postures and monitor our reaction is particularly effective here. The second point that Goffman makes about these displays of female powerlessness is that they have become sexualized. He says they are also a conventionalized expression of sexual availability. In this way, commercial realism shares a great deal with the world of pornography in its expression of female sexuality, in that it is overwhelmingly coded as submissive, powerless and dependent. And when feminine identity in the culture is predominantly equated with this version of sexuality, then femininity itself as a whole is defined as submissive, powerless and dependent. Viewed through this lens, the difference between femininity and masculinity is stark. A difference illustrated very clearly when men are pictured in the scene. The men are active, alert, ready to respond to or to initiate action. The women are defenseless and in no position to initiate any action or to defend themselves. They are powerless, whether it is draped over an operating table or on their knees tugging at a dress in front of a muscled male or sitting on the floor at his feet looking up with the desire to serve. Again, Goffman's point is that while occasionally we can see the reverse, what matters is that it is rare. The one place you can more readily find men in these postures is in some photography of gay men. So, for example, you can see images here of the ritualization of subordination, where men are lying down in much the same manner as women in commercial photography. What that should tell us is that there is nothing natural in gender terms about the action or the pose. That its link with femininity in the mainstream culture and commercial imagery is not inevitable or biological, but profoundly cultural. In fact, what seems to connect these stereotypical feminine poses with these stereotypical gay male poses is the fact that they share the same presumed audience, men. In each case, the subjects of these photos, whether male or female, are there to be looked at by men. And so they embody cultural assumptions about male desire, about what men want. So rather than nature, we could say that one of the things that is being expressed is something that lies outside the frame of these images. The very cultural notion of the male perspective, of what the power of the one looking does to the one being looked at. In this way, it is not just femininity or masculinity that is being expressed, but instead a relationship of subordination between watcher and watched.
Every society has to have a story about happiness, of how we can become happy, what we should strive for to be happy. And the advertising system gives a very specific answer to that question for our society. Advertising tells us the way to happiness and satisfaction is through the consumption of objects. Commodities will make us happy. In one sense, that's what every single ad tells us. And when consumption is so central to the way the economy functions, that shouldn't come as a surprise. The immense accumulation of commodities has to be sold, and it's sold through the story of goods bringing happiness.
The moisturizing lather, the silky smooth skin, never is getting clean. Been this much fun.
So economic growth is not simply needed to provide jobs, but because it'll give us access to more things that will make us happy. So that's why we need to produce more. In fact, I'd say that it's this story that happiness comes from the market, from economic growth. That is, in fact, the major motivating force for social change on a global scale as we head to the 21st century.
Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. We're going to the promised land.
It's the new fragrance for women, Clinique Happy. Wear it and be happy.
In fact, in the stories of advertising, not only happiness, but political freedom itself is offered by access to an immense accumulation of commodities. There's a famous Wendy's ad that featured the Soviet fashion show that illustrated what was wrong with communism was that there was no choice in consumption.
It's next day, bear! It's next swim bear! It's next evening bear! Very nice!
Having no choice is no fun. That's why at Wendy's, every hamburger isn't dressed the same.
These are very powerful stories that equate happiness and freedom with consumption. And advertising is the main propaganda arm of this view.
Top speed, speed dry nail color.
Sets you free in 90 seconds. Revlon.
The question we need to pose at this point, that's normally not asked, is it true? Does happiness come from material things? Do we get happier as a society as we get richer, as we have access to more things? And in general, the answer to that question is no. There were a series of surveys done in the United States starting in 1945 called the Happiness Surveys. And in these surveys, what the researchers wanted to find was how people thought about their own subjective happiness. And what they found was that despite the fact that we have gotten richer in that time, that we have access to far more commodities, that our standard of living is undoubtedly higher, the number of people who reported themselves as very happy has remained remarkably stable. So we have access to more wealth, but are no happier as a society. You know, why should that be?
Their goal is to insinuate their brands into the fabric of children's lives.
So many children's characters' principal function is really to hook kids on products. They're designed to pull on kids' heartstrings.
It's your chance to make the Little Mermaid part of your world.
And then who's holding the strings? Well, it's the marketers who want to sell kids a wide variety of products.
So you end up having junk food promotions at fast food restaurants. Breakfast cereals with images of the main characters from the movies. You have bed sheets so the children literally go to bed thinking about the images. And then they go to school with their backpacks and their lunch boxes with the logos. And then they get to school and their friends have on the t-shirts and the shoes and they want them.
Hello, Scooby-Doo crackers.
Scooby-Doo? Do you like those?
Yeah.
Have you ever had them?
No.
How do you know you like them?
So.
SpongeBob SquarePants was Kraft's best-selling macaroni and cheese. I personally know a five-year-old who told her father in no uncertain terms that SpongeBob SquarePants macaroni and cheese tastes better than any other macaroni and cheese. Now, how do you argue with a five-year-old about that? I mean, what do you say? You say, well, no, it doesn't. And then she says, well, yeah, it does. Well, no, really, it does. No, it does. I know it does. Well, have you ever had SpongeBob SquarePants macaroni and cheese? No, but I know that it tastes better.
What the media do is help to construct violent masculinity as a cultural norm. In other words, violence isn't so much a deviation as it is an accepted part of masculinity. We have to start examining this system and offering alternatives, because one of the major consequences of all of this is that there's been a growing connection made in our society between being a man and being violent. In fact, some of the most serious problems in contemporary American society, especially those connected with violence, can be looked at as essentially problems in contemporary American masculinity.
For example, over 85% of the people who commit murder are men, and the women that do often do so as a defense against men who are battering them. 90% of people who commit violent physical assault are men. 95% of serious domestic violence is perpetrated by males, and it's been estimated that one in four men will use violence against a partner in their lifetime. Over 95% of dating violence is committed by men, and very often it's young men in their teens. Studies have found that men are responsible for between 85 and 95% of child sexual abuse, whether the victim is female or male. And 99.8% of people in prison convicted of rape are men.
In one particularly striking example, some very interesting research a few years ago found that men who had been convicted of some sort of physical assault on another person made choices about who a good victim of their violence would be. That is, they didn't attack just anyone, but picked victims who gave non-verbal cues by their body postures that they would be an easy target and not fight back. Tellingly, the way femininity is defined through these gender displays is precisely what the perpetrators said they were looking for in victims. In a perverse way, the mainstream media landscape, which seems so normal, so unworthy of our serious critical attention, actually reproduces and dangerously glamorizes images of women as weak and vulnerable in stereotypically victim-ready poses. It seems worth noting in this context that women's self-defense classes teach almost exactly the opposite of what the culture tells us about femininity. That to be in charge of your own body and its safety, to be alert and autonomous, to not present yourself as weak and vulnerable, is the key to securing your safety. What does it mean when the visual culture that surrounds us repeatedly idealizes the polar opposite of this kind of feminine power and strength?
If you look at the advertising of the end of the 19th century and the first years of the 20th century, you'll see that advertising talked a lot about the properties of goods, what they did, how well they did it, and so on. But starting in the 1920s, the advertising industry shifts to talking about the relationship of objects to the social life of people. They started to connect commodities, the things they have to sell, with the powerful images of a deeply desired social life that people say they want. No wonder then that advertising is so attractive to us, so powerful, so seductive, because what it offers us are images of the real sources of human happiness: family life, romance and love, sexuality and pleasure, friendship and sociability, leisure and relaxation, independence and control of life. That's why advertising is so powerful. That's what's real about it in one sense. The cruel illusion of advertising, however, is in the way it links those things which we want to a place that by definition cannot provide it, the market and goods.
Oh, look at that!
Is it a mirage or just product placement?
Hey, who cares? With shopping convenience at such low prices, water, Fresca, Mountain Dew, your product name here.
Product placement is weaving of products into programming without adequate disclosure.
Welcome to Wendy's. May I take your order, please?
Classic triple, lettuce, tomato, and cheese.
I got it.
Classic.
I'm gonna have chicken nuggets.
What kind of toys there?
And so it's dishonest advertising. It's deceptive advertising. It sneaks by children's critical faculties and implants its messages in kids' brains when they're paying less attention.
American Idol, which is a top-rated television program for 2 to 11-year-olds, is just rife with Coca-Cola product placement.
American Idol is brought to you by Coca-Cola.
The Gilmore Girls eat Pop-Tarts for breakfast.
Are you enjoying your breakfast?
I don't know if I like Pop-Tarts.
Did you fall on your head while you were sleeping?
I don't know. Do I like this? Is this something I like?
Children's films have product placement in them. I mean, what, Spy Kids had McDonald's as a plot point. And also product placement is getting more and more prevalent in video games.
And when ads haven't been serving as a backdrop in video games, they have become the video game.
With children now as likely to be on the internet as in the playground, they're exposed to so much advertising, they learn to ignore it. That's why advertisers love internet games. Not just ads, not just games, they're advergames. She can score with Skittles, race with Chips Ahoy, or hang out with SpongeBob.
It's part of this by any means necessary. I mean, we've got to get to the kid. We've got to make sure that that child is indoctrinated as a consumer cadet. So therefore, we've got to get to them in ways that maybe they don't even know that we're getting to them.
This new world of advertising in entertainment and entertainment as advertising no longer seems to recognize any boundaries, especially with the rise of new media technologies.
Some of my friends, they'll just like walk around like, you know, they're better than everybody and they're tough and all that stuff. And then like I'd be alone with them and they'd be like the biggest baby. If they had like a problem with like a girlfriend or something, they'd be like crying and stuff. But when they're around a lot of people, they've got like that big front. They gotta be like, you know, tough.
Many cultural analysts would argue that if you want to understand the meaning of something in society, look at its representation in the media, what stories are being told about it in the popular culture. And if we look at images of men and masculinity over the last 50 years, we see that there have been some dramatic and really interesting changes in what is considered to be masculine, especially in terms of the size of men's bodies. For example, if you compare the Superman of the 1950s to what we now think of as the Man of Steel, you'll see a fairly dramatic difference. If you think about Batman and Adam West as Batman in the 1960s and look at his body and compare it to the Batman of the movies of the 90s, there's a fairly dramatic difference. How about pro wrestling? Pro wrestlers' bodies in the 1960s were more flabby, if you will. If you look at them in the 80s and 90s, they become much bigger and stronger and more rippled. If you look at the Star Wars toy figurines that kids play with in the 1970s and contrast them with the Star Wars toy figurines that are being marketed to kids in the 1990s, you see a dramatic shift. There really is something happening here. Something's going on. Look at the way that the body of G.I. Joe, the doll that millions of boys play with, has changed over the last 20 years. Researchers have calculated that the size of his biceps, in real-life equivalents, has increased from 12.2 inches in 1964 to 15.2 inches in 1974 to 16.4 inches in 1994 and up to 26.8 inches by 1998. If you wanted a comparison to a real person, Mark McGuire's biceps are only 20 inches. As I said, something is really going on.
Some of Goffman's most intriguing insights about gender come from his analysis of the relationship between girls and women in the culture. He argues that while boys have to prove themselves in some rite of passage to signify that they have left childhood behind, women, even adult women, never leave girlhood behind. In a wonderful turn of phrase, Goffman says that boys have to push their way into manhood, and problematic effort is involved, while girls merely have to unfold. In advertising, this is reflected in a couple of ways. First, little girls and grown women are presented as essentially the same, wearing the same clothes, having the same hair, doing the same things. In the world of commercial realism, women never seem to leave girlhood behind. In fact, it seems that all they want to do is to get back to the world of childhood.
When you were two, there was no greater joy than the feeling of being naked. Fruit of the Loom makes panties and now bras. Yes, bras. All in 100% comfortable, skin-soft fabrics. So 20 years later, you can get that feeling all over again. Fruit of the Loom.
The second way in which women are linked with childhood is by being presented in infantilized ways. For example, just as children put their fingers in their mouths when nervous, uncertain, or shy, so women are shown taking on similar poses. Their expression, anxious and uneasy, drawing a ritualistic link to childhood. And there are many variations on this theme. It can be combined with one of the ritualized positions of subordination, like lying down, or even in a fetal curled up pose. It crops up in the presence of a man, or even on your wedding day. There can also be an explicitly sexualized dimension to this finger to mouth pose. When combined with a coy turn to the viewer, The mixing of adult sexuality with childhood is straightforward and clear. These stereotypical displays of infantilism are mixed with hints of sex so frequently that the association has come to seem unremarkable, natural, and normal. Again, we can see how inextricably linked this pose is with our understanding of femininity when we see it utilized by men and are jarred by our reaction. And that is Goffman's point. Only when the code gets broken does it become visible in other contexts. Further, like children who often peek from behind things to pretend that they can't be seen, women are also shown hiding themselves in an endless variety of ways. Behind their hands and arms, behind clothes like gloves and hats, behind objects like shopping bags, newspapers, or ornate clocks, or peering from behind walls, curtains, or even a pool table. Nowhere is this childlike masquerade more prominent than in fashion shows. No matter how ridiculous women look, it doesn't matter. And this must be because they're not fully grown or developed human persons. They're children. And again, if we're tempted to say this is all just an innocent and playful aesthetic spectacle, we might ask why men are also not presented in this way, and why, when they are, it is so often played for comedy. The link between womanhood and childhood is further reinforced when women are repeatedly shown hugging each other like giggling schoolgirls. And it is reinforced some more when they hold themselves in a vulnerable and uncertain way, or tug at their dress in a girlish way, or hide under their skirts. An especially clear illustration of how our cultural codes of gender tend to link womanhood with girlhood can be seen in the adaptation of the famous Coppertone ads that historically featured a little girl having her underwear pulled down by a dog. In the modern version, on the cover of Esquire, the adult Carmen Electra now takes the place of the little girl in exactly the same pose, except that now it has also been sexualized. This movement to presenting grown adult women as little girls reached one of its most extreme forms in this Harper's Bazaar layout featuring the 19-year-old model Gemma Ward, made to appear as though she is 10 or 11. Amazingly, the title of the spread was "And God Created Woman." Whereas in the 1950s, Brigid Bardot was a symbol for this, in the contemporary period, it is now the image of a little girl that stands for womanhood. One of the obvious consequences of presenting adult women this way is not only that grown women become equated with childhood, but that young girls have increasingly become equated with mature womanhood, presented as full-blown sexualized subjects, utilizing the familiar ritualized codes of adult femininity. I'm not sure that we as a society have realized the possible consequences, not least for the developing identities of young girls, of populating our cultural spaces with images like these.
The internet allows people to be micro-targeted. If you have the person's birthday, you could say, "Happy birthday, Billy. Have you seen the new Power Ranger watch?" It's very personal.
If you set up 5 different accounts from 5 different geographic areas on different genders, on different ages, with different preferences, you will see 5 different ads. You will see 5 different worlds. Now, as a child, you don't know that. As a child, you're competing with MBAs. You're competing with some of the smartest people out there.
In the face of these developments, many critics of youth marketing have called on schools to develop media literacy curricula to help kids navigate commercial culture. The results have sometimes been less than encouraging.
Now a word from our sponsor.
That's how some schools are making extra money, literally selling themselves to advertisers.
Everything from the band shell.
That will be $125,000.
To the lecture hall.
$150,000.
Can be named for a price at New Berlin schools.
There's advertising on school walls, on school buses, in gymnasiums. There's donated scoreboards that have the Coca-Cola or the Pepsi logo on them.
There are so many ways that commercialism has intruded into our classrooms. There's Coke and Pepsi and Cadbury Schweppes in the schools, which are helping to generate an epidemic of childhood obesity among our kids across the country. There's school book covers. There are sponsored educational materials. There's a company called Field Trip Factory, which takes kids to places like Petco and to Sports Authority and calls that education.
The Chicago kindergartners are on a school field trip, but the animals they're going to see aren't in the zoo.
We want to welcome you to Petco.
Across the country, a growing number of schools are taking America's classrooms to America's malls.
And there's a new company called Bus Radio, which is trying to compel a million kids to listen to 8 minutes of advertisements per hour as they ride the school bus.
Bus Radio.
BusRadio.com. We'll choose a name at random, and if you're the winner, we'll give a pair of tickets to your bus driver, too. You guys can hang out together, maybe share a large Coke. Email us as soon as you get home.
There's Channel One, which compels about 7 million children to watch ads in schools each school day.
Today on Channel One.
The purpose of schools, in part, is to promote reason. And the purpose of advertising is to subvert reason, to promote the sale of a product. And for that reason alone, advertising has no proper place in the schools.
A culture dominated by commercial messages that tells individuals that the way to happiness is through consuming objects gives a very particular answer to the question of what is society? What is it that binds us together in some kind of collective way? In fact, Margaret Thatcher, the former Conservative British Prime Minister, gave the most succinct answer to this question from the viewpoint of the market. She said, "There is no such thing as society. There are just individuals and their families." That is, there is nothing solid we can call society. There are no group values, no collective interest. Society is just a bunch of individuals acting on their own. And in fact, that is precisely how advertising talks to us. It addresses us not as members of society talking about collective issues, but as individuals. It talks about our individual needs and desires. It does not talk about those things we have to negotiate collectively. Things like poverty, like healthcare, like housing and the homeless, like the environment. The market appeals to the worst things, greed, selfishness, and discourages what is the best about us. Things like compassion, caring, and generosity. Again, this shouldn't surprise us. In those societies where the marketplace dominates, then what will be stressed is what the marketplace can deliver. And advertising is the main voice of the marketplace. In that sense, advertising systematically relegates discussion of key societal issues to the peripheries of the culture, to the margins, and talks in powerful ways instead of individual desire, of individual fantasy, of individual pleasure and comfort.
This idea that men of color need to adopt this hyper-masculine posture in order to get the respect they've been stripped of by the dominant culture is common in many groups of men of color. For example, Richard Majors has written a book called Cool Pose, where he talks about the phenomenon of poor urban African-American men walking around like tough guys because that's all they have going for them in terms of gaining respect and the validation of their manhood. For example, a lot of poor urban black males don't have access to a good education or the expectation of a good career, or they don't have a lot of status in the community. This isn't their fault. The social and economic structures of society have systematically denied them the access and opportunities that middle-class people take for granted. But one thing that hasn't been taken from them is the ability to use their bodies and poses to scare people, to front like tough guys, so that they can get respect. Anyone who's worked with poor and working-class boys over the past generation has seen this cool pose, this tough guys, over and over. Now, one of the really interesting things that's happened in the last decade, largely as a result of the popularity of rap and hip-hop music, is that this urban black street style has made its way into the mainstream culture, especially through places like MTV. And as that's happened, these images of the cool pose, the tough guys, have become glamorized and idealized, so that at the present time, one of the most powerful images of manhood that young men of all races and of all classes are looking to as an ideal or a model to emulate is the glamorized image of the hyper-violent black male body and this urban street style.
Weapon, tech, my tech's like tech, and the industry weapon, I'm Gino X, bring KRS in.
Many people have commented on what seems to be the strange phenomenon of white suburban middle-class kids acting black. But that shouldn't surprise us at all if we understand that there's nothing natural or inherent about masculinity. It's largely about playing a role defined by broader structures. So that even if the lives of middle-class white boys don't reflect the inner-city conditions out of which the black coup pose arose as a response, they live in a culture that tells them that being a real man means taking on this black urban hard guy pose.
Yeah. Yo, shouldn't you be getting your freak on by now, man?
Oh, yo, I'm just flossing one of those two hoes over there scratching that over. Who gets to knock the boots with me, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Damn, woman, why you gotta be such a raging bitch?
Oh, please, listen to you. Look, there's a mirror right there. Why don't you take a look, okay? You're white.
What this phenomenon of posing shows us is that an important part of masculinity is the very performance of it, and that these white kids are learning this from the pop cultural images they're exposed to every day of their lives. But we can take this back one step and ask, if masculinity is a pose, where did urban blacks get the inspiration for their own performance? Of course, people borrow from many places, their communities, their family histories, popular culture, and many other places. As the writer Nathan McCall has said, he and some of his African-American male cohorts got some of their ideas about manhood from gangster films like The Godfather and other films that featured tough, ruthless, white Italian gangsters.
Someday, and that day may never come, I'll call upon you to do a service for me. But until that day, accept this justice as a gift on my daughter's wedding day.
One day, and that day may never come, I'm gonna call you to do something for me. Until then, take this justice as a gift. All right?
Thank you, Godfather.
So I gave my cellular number and told her to call me up. Beating on my dashboard.
So we have this interesting phenomenon where we have white middle-class males emulating poor urban black males who in turn are getting part of their idea about manhood from gangster films featuring white Italian men.
Do you have the code? The ultimate code of seduction. The Armani code.
While Goffman's analysis focuses a great deal on the gender displays associated with femininity, it would be a mistake to say that he has nothing of significance to say about masculinity. And that is because masculinity, the ideal of what it means to be a man, is always defined in relation to what it means to be a girl or a woman. It is virtually impossible to speak of one without reference to the other. They are part of one complex. Masculinity in particular is defined through what it is not, through its opposite, meaning what the culture defines as feminine. So masculinity is not about powerlessness, it is about power. It is not about defenselessness, but about always being prepared. It's not about being childlike, but always being grown up and an adult. It's not about showing weakness, but always maintaining emotional control. Standing upright with hands in pockets is a common pose that communicates this kind of easy confidence and strength. It suggests comfort as well as control of the world that surrounds them. A stronger and more aggressive variation of this posture features the arms folded, looking out at the viewer. It projects confidence and even intimidation, if not outright menace and threat. Rarely, if ever, are men shown in feminine, canting postures that depict them as off balance or ungrounded. Rarely, if ever, are they forced into the kinds of absurd contortions that define the feminine code. Instead, they are coded masculine, upright and prepared for whatever might come their way. Independent, within themselves, in control of the situation. Their gaze directed outward, rather than inviting us to gaze at them. The position of the body communicates self-assurance, poise, and self-possession. And when they're not projecting power and control, men display a relaxed calm, an almost unperturbed presence. They're portrayed in a laid-back, casual, and yet grounded manner that seems utterly foreign to the women of advertising. And of course, they're also active in the world, alive in their surroundings, taking charge in a positive, self-assured, and assertive manner. Interestingly, the only time we see this masculine code of control breached in the culture is in exceptional circumstances, such as the reaction of brokers to the extreme stress of the financial meltdown. The poses and codes are classically feminine, and looked at out of context, these images look strange because we do not think of normal masculinity in this way.
One means of fine-tuning is the tried-and-true method of the focus group.
It's quiet, it's controlled, there's usually a one-way mirror, so we can see behavioral cues. It's how they look, it's the look in their eyes, especially with kids who don't have that sense yet of self-monitoring. You know, all their actions are very descriptive, and once we take what they say and then feed that in with how they look when they say it and their behavioral cues, we really end up with a strong measurement of how product affects them.
Still another means is ethnographic research, which, tuned to the goals of marketers, has become a kind of scientific stalking.
They go into supermarkets with them and film exactly how they look at a product, pick it up, put it back down, the way they move around a supermarket. They film them on the playground. They film them in school. They film them eating breakfast. They film them going into their closet and deciding what to wear.
What are the things that you need that aren't in here?
I need a lot of...
They film them talking to their friends. They organize little friendship circles and film what they're doing. They even follow them into the bathroom. I interviewed a number of people who sat and watched children take baths and showers, watched how they interact with shampoo and soap and health and beauty products, as that category is called, in order to go back and write a report for their clients on, you know, what to do with the packaging. It's creepy. It's just absolutely creepy, the way children are being dissected and put under the microscope by marketers.
You read headlines in newspapers all around the country about this problem of kids killing kids.
But after 10 school shootings in 3 years, there is more detail and a profile developing of kids who kill kids.
But this isn't kids killing kids. Overwhelmingly, it's boys killing boys and boys killing girls. An example of the way the media degenders discussion of violence can be seen in the coverage of the Jonesboro, Arkansas massacre in the spring of 1998. There were all these headlines about kids killing kids and children killing children and what's going on with our kids, et cetera, et cetera. In fact, one article in the New York Times, a think piece that was a step back piece to try to discuss the whole issue of all this range of school shootings, in one parenthesis said all of these shootings were done by boys. And then what was in the parentheses wasn't discussed in the rest of the article. So you have a whole article trying to pull together all the different factors that are causing these shootings. And the one most important, in my opinion, is in the parentheses and not discussed. We should be thinking about these school shootings in the same way that miners thought about the canaries they took down into the mine shafts to warn them of unseen dangers. The school shootings are just the very tip of the iceberg. In fact, 15 kids every day in this country are shot dead by other kids, and boys overwhelmingly are the victims and the shooters. That's like a Columbine happening every single day. Deadly violence involving young people has been a fact of life for years in communities of color, but the mainstream media just reports it matter-of-factly. But because it's happening now in white, middle-class neighborhoods, all of a sudden it's a major national concern, because now it's quote-unquote normal kids who are involved. That's what's shocking to a lot of people. The Jonesboro, Arkansas case in the spring of 1998 is a good example of this.
A teacher and four girls are dead. One was 11 years old, the rest of them 12. Police say boys aged 13 and 11 were arrested near the school carrying guns and wearing camouflage.
These are two seemingly quote-unquote normal boys. They didn't meet any of the definitions of a pathological sick killer.
The consumer vision that is pushed by advertising and which is conquering the world is based fundamentally, of course, on a notion of economic growth.
more consumption requires more production. So it is pushing industrial production. Now, industrial production has costs. It requires resources, raw materials and energy. And there is now broad consensus among environmental scholars that the Earth simply cannot sustain present levels of economic expansion, especially as more and more third world nations transform their economies to industrial economies. We simply cannot keep going the way we have. Look at resource depletion. We are running out of vital supplies, and if we project into the future, we can anticipate when we may run out. That is, if we take what we know we have, known reserves, and we generously anticipate for what we may be able to find, and we correlate that with what we will need based on predicted levels of economic growth, then we have a timetable for when we will run out.
What's amazing when you look at Disney and Disney movies over the years is how little the image of females has really changed. You still have the same highly sexualized female body with the big breasts, the tiny waists, the fluttering eyelashes, the coy expressions, the seductress. These images seem very similar over the years, and even when they're in animal form, you know, you've got this very seductive little female animal.
Hello.
What we find is that this presents people with a kind of notion of what femininity is about. This is not a mirror on society. This is not reflecting who women really are or what females really are. It is basically constructing notions of what femininity is. And these are not notions that necessarily Disney invented, but what they do with these notions is they caricature them. They wrap them up in this Magic Kingdom wrapper and they sell them to children. And that's really the power of Disney.
There's been a lot of discussion of this recently, where people have blamed violent video games or Hollywood films or even rock stars like Marilyn Manson. But that's such a narrow and wrong way to look at this. Sure, video games and movies play a role, but they do it within a much larger cultural and social context where the constant message is that manhood is connected to power, control, and violence. That is, it's not just in these few places, like video games or movies, but it's in what passes for normal culture. It is part of the normal training and conditioning and socializing of boys and men. That's a point that a lot of people don't want to hear, but if you look at the culture these kids are immersed in, violence is a normal and natural part, not just of the world, but of being masculine or being a male person in the world. We can see this really clearly if we look at a childhood picture of Andrew Golden, one of the Jonesboro killers. From the earliest age, the link between guns and manhood is made clear to young boys.
Since Goffman developed his analysis, an apparently code-breaking new representation of femininity has also emerged. In contrast to the traditional code of submissiveness, powerlessness and childishness, we've seen the rise of prominent representations of feminine power, captured in the emergence of the female action hero, a seemingly new ideal of women as active, aggressive, and in control. Far from being flailing, off-balance airheads and victims, these are tough girls who kick butt. Whether it's Jennifer Garner as Elektra, or Uma Thurman in Kill Bill, single-handedly taking on a score of men, Stop! or Angelina Jolie as Lara Croft in Tomb Raider, dispensing her own brand of justice. These women seem to be different, never backing down, sometimes even vicious. But for all these displays of stereotypical masculine power, and what appears to be a new brand of female autonomy and strength, what may be most notable here is how even this new brand of superhero-sized power isn't enough to break the old feminine codes. The most striking example of this phenomena appears in the recent Charlie's Angels series of movies, where you have three women who appear confident, empowered, in charge, controlling the action, really the authors of their own fate.
Put the sleeper on.
But keep watching, and you see that the traditional gender code is never far from the surface. There's a very interesting sequence in the first film in the series where the character played by Lucy Liu is talking to a group of supposedly nerdy programmers trying to get them to do something for her. She's acting very forcefully, using a whip aggressively, and talking in an empowered manner. So, on the one hand, she is breaking or expanding the standard gender code. But at the same time, when she wants the men to do something for her, she transforms instantly into the opposite. Seductive and submissive.
Tell me! Better yet, can anyone show me?
All the standard codes are there. The legs twisted, the body canted, the head tilted, hair being twirled. Now, there is no doubt that the filmmakers are using the codes of gender in an ironic and playful way here. But there are many other incidents in the films that use the standard codes of female sexuality, without irony, to prove that the angels really still are just girls, despite being powerful and empowered. Whether it's Lucy Liu giving a very unconventional kind of massage, or Cameron Diaz practicing her dance moves in front of a mirror, or Drew Barrymore wandering around in a towel, or holding a group of men at bay between her open legs, the female body is used in a way that is at odds with the idea of autonomy and independence. In fact, this was taken to absurd lengths in a photo shoot for the men's magazine Maxim, where these three actresses were presented in the most childlike and submissive poses, fingers in their mouths, giggling like young schoolgirls, shown on all fours crawling around, lying down with head tilted, biting on fingers. That is, they are shown not merely sexualized, but by utilizing the ritualized codes of femininity, subordinate, powerless, and frivolous as well. This is also true for Angelina Jolie in Tomb Raider, which not only features her naked in both films, but dressed in clothes that highlight a very conventional sexual identity. It's as if viewers need to be reassured not only that she is female as she lays waste to male bodies, but that she is womanly, just so things don't get too confusing. And similarly, when the prostitutes of Sin City are mowing their male enemies down in the finale of the film, they do it in teddies, garters, and stockings. This seems to be the required uniform when women are allowed to take control in the world. Although, even here, it is pretty clear who is really in charge.
And so am I.
One important part of the culture that teaches boys and men how to be men is the sports culture. Sports is an incredibly important institution. It's pervasive in our society, and young boys and girls learn a whole lot from an early age about life, about teamwork. There's some positive lessons, certainly, that young people playing sports learn from an early age. Some of the ways that the sports culture has grown increasingly aggressive and violent, and we see that in hockey fights and baseball fights, we'd be naive to think that the way grown men act, on the field or off, has no impact on how boys learn to think of themselves as men. But it's important to remember that what's being taught in a lot of modern sports is not just violence and aggression, but the even more powerful idea that being a real man is connected with being intimidating and controlling. Just look at what happens when a basketball player does an in-your-face dunk over his opponent and then rubs it in. The lesson about manhood is clear. You gain respect by disrespecting another person.
The Girls Intelligence Agency.
Not the CIA, it's the Girls Intelligence Agency, which, for all the cloak and dagger, is actually a marketing firm.
The Girls Intelligence Agency claims to have tens, if not hundreds of thousands of girls across the country that it is in contact with and working with. The signature product of the GIA is something called the Slumber Party in a Box.
Guys, sacred opening of the case.
Kids are asked to sort of push a certain product, or they're more like focus group parties where kids are asked to come and give their opinions on products.
What is the hottest item? The sleep mask, the fuzzy phone, or the beauty kits?
Fuzzy phone.
They ask them to be sly. They ask them to get information on their friends without their friends knowing about it. It's teaching children to exploit their friends for the purpose of getting money or free products.
What happened at your home the other day, marketing, or was it a party?
It was kind of both. It was a party for us, but it was marketing for the company.
And is that cool with you?
Definitely.
One of the more problematic aspects of its behavior is that it will enlist young children in its marketing efforts without their parents knowing about it.
There's a lot that's happening around us, and the public is not aware, just like they're not aware of neuromarketing. And that's another whole scary thing, to put a child in an MRI and then watch what is lighting up inside his brain based on the stimulus, and then saying, wow, this works, this is good, look what happens.
They do blink tests on kids, for example. They develop ads and then see how frequently a kid blinks or turns their eyes away. And when they see the kid blinking more, they change the ad to make it more mesmerizing. There's stuff they just can't take their eyes off. And it's not an accident. They've gone over and over and over with extensive high-tech kinds of testing devices to find the precise configuration of characters, colors, music, words, and so forth that kids can't resist.
When you look at the image of Snow White today, you know, with a sort of feminist sensibility, you realize how ridiculous the image is. Here you've got this young female, completely isolated, at home, enjoying cooking and cleaning, and her friends are the animals, and she's happy. I mean, it just makes no sense today, given that feminism and feminist discourse has seeped down into everyday life.
Now you wash the dishes, you tidy up the room, you clean the fireplace, and I'll use the broom.
So what Disney has to do in order to keep up with the themes of a society is they have to keep changing. In Little Mermaid, you know, she does defy her father. There is a sense of a more powerful female here.
I set certain rules, and I expect those rules to be obeyed.
You don't even know him.
Know him? I don't have to know him. They're all the same, capable of any feeling.
Daddy, I love him!
And of course, ultimately, she's willing to give up her voice to get the mail. And once she's given up the voice, the only thing she has left to get him is the body. Now, a more interesting, complex reality is Mulan, where this is a very powerful, strong character who almost single-handedly wins the war. And so we do have a real independent female. However, after the war, and she goes home, then the expectations of femininity are exactly the same. It's as if it never happened.
Great. She brings home a sword. If you ask me, she should have brought home a man.
Excuse me. Does Fa Mulan live here?
We have examples like Beauty and the Beast, where their argument was this is a strong, powerful woman. And why is she strong and powerful? Because she's reading a book.
Ah, Belle!
Good morning. I've come to return the book I borrowed.
Finished already?
Oh, I couldn't put it down. Have you got anything new?
Well, in reality, it's just a pseudo-feminism. Because ultimately, in Beauty and the Beast, is that she marries a batterer.
So if we take this broader view of media violence, we can see that significantly reducing violence involves much more than simply stopping young boys from playing violent video games or watching violent movies. Because the messages that link being a man with being violent, controlling, and intimidating are everywhere in the culture, such as sports and wrestling, as well as the more obvious places like video games and films. If we want to deal seriously with reducing violence, we have to turn away from thinking about it as kids imitating violence and focus instead on all the different ways that we as a society are constructing violent masculinity as a cultural norm, not as something unusual or unexpected, but as one of the ways that boys become men.
Nice jacket. Abercrombie?
Please, it's Dior. Why, is yours from A&F?
Our mom bought it for him at Kmart.
I think the thing that upsets me the most is that it's not just products that are being marketed to children, but values. And the primary value that's being sold to kids over and over and over again is the value that things or stuff or brands will make us happy.
The costs of participating in the consumer culture for children have escalated dramatically.
I like your bike, I like your pony, but I love it, my Sony.
15 years ago, the My First Sony, which would be, you know, a kid's version of a tape recorder or a music player, would cost far less than the adult version. But today, it's an iPod. In grades, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 even, very, very expensive products. We're seeing elementary school girls, 6, 7-year-olds, articulating adamant preferences for designer jeans that cost $100 to $150. That's part of that shift from children's culture being a cheap culture to a very upscale children's culture in which it's not only branded, but it's designer branded.
Fetch me my Jimmy Choo flip-flops. Where is my pink Prada tote? I need my Tiffany hairband.
It's gotta have it, gimme. That's the value system.
I want more.
Self-indulgence, instant gratification, and materialism.
Everything's got to be perfect for me.
That's the basic consumer identity.
You could try thinking of things that remind you of each note. Do.
Oh,
that's easy. Do means money.
It's shallow. It's about me.
Me.
Yay! It's about me now, and it's about me and these things.
Law. Law is something you get to break if you're rich.
That's the attitude. It's all about me.
You know it's all about me. You know it's all about me. You know it's all about me. You know it's all about me.
I say it. These marketers are very similar to pedophiles. Okay? They are child experts. If you're going to be a pedophile or a child marketer, you have to know about children and what children are going to want.
Kids love advertising. It's a gift. It's something they want. There's something to be said, by the way, about being there first and about branding children and owning them in that way. And antisocial behavior in pursuit of a product is a good thing.
So if we take this broader view of media violence, we can see that significantly reducing violence involves much more than simply stopping young boys from playing violent video games or watching violent movies. Because the messages that link being a man with being violent, controlling, and intimidating are everywhere in the culture, such as sports and wrestling, as well as the more obvious places like video games and films. If we want to deal seriously with reducing violence, we have to turn away from thinking about it as kids imitating violence and focus instead on all the different ways that we as a society are constructing violent masculinity as a cultural norm, not as something unusual or unexpected, but as one of the ways that boys become men.
Express yourself, girl, let it all hang out. Just do your thing, ain't nothing to worry about.
One of the crucial aspects of this trend is that marketers never communicate their adult messages and values to kids simply as kids, but as boys and as girls.
And girls are being taught they need to be pretty, sexy, and what they buy determines their value, and how they look determines their value.
It's true that to some extent, advertisers have always appealed to girls at this level.
Barbie, you're beautiful.
But there can be little doubt that something radically different has emerged over the past few years.
It's my scene, my bling, bling, bling.
The new My Scene, My Bling Bling girls are here.
Nice bling.
Here, wear my ring.
Ooh, sparkly.
You see now dolls with highly sexualized outfits and themes marketed to 6-year-olds.
Brats, forever diamonds.
I go to visit preschools, and I'll see 4-year-old girls in what I often call crotch skirts, modeled after Bratz dolls.
That's so cute.
I would seriously wear that.
Thanks. Be Bratz. Be one.
While one part of you, cognitively, may be able to accept belly shirts when you're 7 years old, are you emotionally mature enough to handle the outcome when you go out in public and people look at you like, an underage Britney Spears?
And with boys, we see the same pattern. While to some degree marketers have long targeted boys with what would seem to be adult messages, messages that equate being a man with aggression and toughness and violence, today's boys are immersed in an altogether different world.
Fire! Exciting!
With boys, what we see is the use of images of violence, power, domination at very young ages.
With video games, for example, we went from 16-bit to 32-bit to 64-bit to 128-bit technology in about 5 years. What that means is that we're getting closer and closer to virtual reality.
The amount of violence, entertainment violence, that young children are exposed to is startling. They're getting a message that when you have conflicts, you fight with violence, that you have to fight in order to resolve your differences. That's what you do. And that watching violence is fun.
What the hell is this? What the hell is this?
It's entertaining.
In 1985, we discovered the existence of a huge hole in the ozone layer over the South Pole that is the size of the continental United States. The activities of humans are changing the very makeup of the Earth. Bill McGibbon, in his book, The End of Nature, reminds us that we have done this ourselves by driving our cars, building our factories, cutting down our forests, turning on air conditioners. He says, the history of the world is full of the most incredible events that change the way we live. But all those changes are dwarfed by what we have done in the last 50 years. He says, man's efforts, even at their mightiest, were tiny compared with the size of the planet. The Roman Empire meant nothing to the Arctic or the Amazon. But now, the way of life of one part of the world in one half century is altering every inch and every hour of the globe. The situation is so bad that the scientific community is desperately trying to get the rest of the world to wake up to the danger. 1,700 of the world's leading scientists, including a majority of Nobel laureates in the sciences, recently issued this appeal. Human beings and the natural world are on a collision course. If not checked, many of our current practices may so alter the living world that it will be unable to sustain life in the manner we know. Fundamental changes are urgent if we are to avoid the collision our present course will bring. It's important to avoid the prediction of immediate catastrophe. We've already done a lot of damage, but the real environmental crisis will not hit until sometime in the middle of the next century. So we have some time, but not much. But to avoid the catastrophe, we have to take action now. We have to put in place the steps that will save us in 70 years' time. The metaphor to think of is that of an oil tanker heading for a crash on the shore. because it's so huge, because of the momentum that has been built up, to stop crashing, the oil tanker has to start turning well before it reaches the coast. We have to anticipate the momentum. If we start turning too late, we will smash into the coast.
Another aspect of violent masculinity and violence that kids are subject to on a daily basis, really, is the really popular genre of film, the slasher film. And one of the things that happens in slasher films, typically, is the violence is not just violent, it's also sexualized violence. So you often have scenes, for example, of girls undressing or taking a shower or wearing sexy low-cut dresses, sometimes even removing clothing at opportune moments, or being positioned in sexually provocative camera angles, deliberately designed to sexually arouse straight boys, and then at the moment the boys are aroused is when the girls are assaulted. So the sexualization of violence might be one of the reasons, one of the areas we need to look at when we talk about why are so many boys and men sexually assaulting girls and women. Because the rates of rape and sexual abuse and sexual assault perpetrated by men against girls and women, as well as against boys, are just out of sight in our society. And even though crime rates in general have been coming down in recent years, the rape rate hasn't, the sexual abuse rate hasn't. We have to ask ourselves, you know, why not? Another popular performer who's tapped into the same kind of anger against women and misogyny is Howard Stern. Stern is often portrayed in the popular discourse as this bad boy who's challenging traditional morality and transgressing against authority. But that's such a superficial reading of what he's doing. What Stern actually does is simply reinforce, in crude fashion, some of the most tired, old-fashioned sexist values.
You wear panties, say? Pull your pants off. What about your bra? Is that coming off?
That bra's got to come off.
You got to take that off.
Okay, all right, ladies, are you ready to disrobe? All right, take off your shirts.
Let me see. Let's face me. They're not horrible, but I think they should be bigger. You have hair on your ass? Well, you girls go to the gym and work out a little bit.
What Stern does is he creates a world for his largely young male audience, a world in which they can feel good about themselves by putting down and sexually degrading women. The gender world might be changing all around them, but on the Howard Stern show, women are bimbos to be stared at and exploited. That is anything but transgressive. Howard Stern is no anti-authority rebel. His shtick absolutely reinforces traditional sexism.
Say a 6, 9, 8, 10. You're like a horse. You're like a fine horse.
A clear indication of how the supposedly lovable Howard embodies contempt for women is in his reaction to the tragic shootings at Columbine High School. When the news first broke about the horrific massacre being perpetrated by Harris and Klebold, the people that Stern identified with were not the boys and girls running for their lives out of the school, but with the male shooters and what he would have done if he was them. On his radio show, he said, and these are his very words, quote, "There were some really good-looking girls running out with their hands over their heads. Did those kids try to have sex with any of the good-looking girls? They didn't even do that? At least if you're going to kill yourself and kill all the kids, why wouldn't you have some sex? If I was going to kill some people, I'd take them out with sex." Unquote. So Howard Stern took the Littleton tragedy as an opportunity to make a rape joke. What a rebel.
The crows. I mean, it's either the crows, the monkeys, the orangutans. They're always the ones that are sort of doing the jive dancing or the hip-hop dancing or the break dancing or the have the kind of slow, slurred speech pattern.
Why, this is most irregular. Well, I just can't believe my eyes. They ain't dead, is they?
No, dead people don't snow.
In Jungle Book, it's that same, you know, the jive and the hustle and the dance and, you know, these gorillas that sound like, and orangutans that sound like black people who want to be like men but will never be men. The buffoon.
I want to be a man cub, and stroll right into town and be just like the other men. I'm tired of walking around. Oh, ooby-doo. I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Talk like you.
We have dealt with decades of Tarzan movies where the white man comes into the jungle and he tames the animals and also tames the natives, and he knows the jungle better than the native people do.
If somebody is going to show a film that in its original version was enormously racist, I guess the first question would be, why would you want to show that anyways? I mean, I guess the second question was, if you do appropriate it, do you have a responsibility, particularly if it's a children's film, to take those constructions and to make them problematic so that kids have an opportunity to hold them up against some kind of critical vocabulary?
Disney animator Glenn Keane was given the difficult task of coming up with a new take on Tarzan.
I've been watching my son do his skateboarding and snowboarding and started thinking of Tarzan as kind of having this attitude of like a surfer kind of a guy.
And then you have the film that Walt Disney comes along in this day and time and produces a Tarzan film without black people at all. So not only have they eliminated the black people in Africa, but they've also eliminated black people's presence.
Kids in Africa see it. They see a white man in Africa who's superior, swinging from trees, and they see no Africans. And they see gorillas being the ones they relate to. What does that mean to an African child? Is it promoting white supremacy to these black African children who watch Tarzan in a movie theater in Africa? Of course it will. And it might be promoting it around the world.
I never seen any black people in Disney's movie.
I can't think of any Disney movies that have black people that are good or bad.
When you produce a discourse as public as that, and you have that kind of power, or the kind of power that allows you to distribute those messages to thousands, if not millions, of children, then you have a responsibility.
The marketplace cannot deal with long-range issues, by definition. It's an institution that's good for dealing with the present. Corporations, the institutions that dominate a market system, think about their profits now. Perhaps next week, possibly even a year down the road. But they do not, they cannot, think 70 years down the road about collective interests. And if we think about advertising, which forms the background on which we have to develop new ways of thinking, it tells a similar story about the future. The time frame of advertising is very short. Its dominant mode is talking about the present. If you're lucky, it may talk about tomorrow. If you're really lucky, it may talk about the following week. But that's about it. It does not encourage us to look a year, 2 years, 10 years, 70 years down the road. And in fact, the present-oriented nature of advertising will increase because of the current situation. First, you have an audience that is cynical about advertising, that tries all it can to avoid it. That's why advertising spreads everywhere, so people cannot avoid it. And as it does that, advertisers are faced with the problem of clutter and noise. In that situation, advertising will be even more connected to the present. It will speak to us more through our bodies than through our heads. It will try and bypass thinking and go straight for the gut, straight for our emotions. That's how you cut through the clutter, to communicate to a cynical and reluctant audience. You smack them, metaphorically, in the mouth. You make the advertising visceral, something you feel, not something you necessarily think.
Sammy Sosa and Mark McGwire, instead of competing with each other and being nasty with each other, like the experience of a lot of men who are vying for the same goal, and that's what a lot of people take for granted is competition, were actually friendly, and it was also across racial lines as well. So they were just not just modeling male cooperation in what many people saw as a competitive environment, but in fact, cross-racial understanding and friendship. The rugged individualist ideal that men are being taught to live up to has enormous emotional and psychological costs because we are not you know, rocks unto ourselves. We are in relation to other human beings. We are interdependent. One of the more really interesting books, and there's been many books written about men's psychological and emotional lives and health over the past decade, is by a man named Terry Real, who wrote about male depression. And the name of his book is I Don't Want to Talk About It. And even the name of the book is interesting, because I Don't Want to Talk About It is the way a lot of men deal with emotional and psychological issues. The vast majority of people in therapy are women. Is that because women have more problems than men? I don't think so. I think it's because there's more permission in the culture for women to get help and to deal with some of their problems, whereas men are being taught from the John Wayne Marlboro Man ethos to suck it up.
Come on now. Suck it up now.
You gotta out tough people when you get down there. It's man on man down there.
You can act like a man. What's the matter with you? Is this how you turn down a Hollywood Pinocchio that cries like a woman?
Pretty good run the ball, Wendell. Really not bad, boy. How you feeling?
I'm tired. It's my knee.
Never show weakness. Never show weakness. Only pain that matters, the pain you inflict.
This idea that I am invulnerable, or that manhood means reckless disregard for personal health and safety, is often behind the kind of risky behaviors that boys and men take on as a way of proving their toughness. This notion of invulnerability gets a lot of young men killed, okay? There's a lot of young men in graves and a lot of mourning families because young boys and young men have bought into this idea of manliness and not backing down and all this kind of stuff. The unhealthy and risk-taking behaviors of young males, the damage they're doing to themselves, to others, and to society, has led many people to label masculinity itself as a public health problem. One way of dealing with this is to intervene in the cultural environment that connects masculinity with invulnerability. We have to show that vulnerability, compassion, and caring are also part of what it means to be a real man. Another area in the popular culture where we've seen some really positive, progressive, and alternative images of masculinity is in popular music. From John Lennon in the 1960s right through to the present, pop music has offered a range of different images of masculinity that go much deeper than the superficiality of the tough guys. Look at the huge and enduring popularity of soul music, where classic male performers like Marvin Gaye, Al Green, and groups like The Temptations express a range of emotions. Look at the incredible career of Stevie Wonder, who's been bringing positive energy and brilliant music for more than three decades. Or Q-Tip from Tribe Called Quest, who has cultivated a thoughtful and emotionally complex image. The popularity of these and other artists suggests that in spite of the hyper-masculine posturing of so many contemporary male performers, people seem to be longing for displays of manhood that move beyond the narrow confines of traditional masculinity. Look at men like the late Kurt Cobain or Michael Stipe of REM or Eddie Vedder of Pearl Jam. These guys have been vocal proponents of women's rights.
It's really hard to find baby paraphernalia that's not plastered with media characters. You can find unbranded baby stuff, but you can find it in high-end toy stores. But if you go to places where poor middle-class families shop, it's all branded. So the babies start out life with the notion of consumption. And that's not an accident. What they want is cradle-to-grave brand loyalty. That's what they talk about. Share of mind. They talk about owning children for life.
Norman Feeney, Pepsi drinker for life.
There's been this recognition, apparently, that children as young as 6 months of age can recognize brands. So now, if they can recognize brands, we've got to make sure that they recognize our brand. The marketer is interested in getting to that child at the very, very beginning to begin to shape that child's worldview, to begin to shape that child's brand preferences, to begin to basically tell the child, in a sense, what that child needs in order to have a meaningful life. And that's where we see, as mothers, that's our job. It's not theirs.
Where to turn in such a world? Millions of parents are now finding some solace in what appears to be a countertrend. It's a new media movement that claims to be good for infants. And whether we're talking about developmental DVDs like Baby Einstein and Brainy Baby, or 24-hour programming for infants and toddlers on TV, the idea is that good media is the best antidote to bad media.
We don't get to decide how tall they'll end up or what their shoe size will be in 2 years. But how big their imaginations get?
Is that your shirt?
Well, we do have some say in that.
The idea is that our kids would be all right if parents would simply turn their children away from the commercial clutter and turn them on to educational media.
Because kids don't just grow up, they think up.
But the question is any of this even true?
There is not one iota of research evidence that shows that they teach children anything, or that the children who experience these things at early ages are any different in terms of their educational capacity or their fund of knowledge later on down the line. It is a huge, hundreds of millions of dollars a year business. And they're selling it to parents' insecurities.
You'll never get into college if you don't play your video game.
They're basically letting parents think that if they don't get these things, their children will be behind.
What will this home video end up being labeled? Kyle and Max in the car? No, Kyle and Max playing.
Cat, we want tea.
Make that Kyle and Max increasing the size of their brains.
The majority of parents think if they don't put their kids in front of media early and often, that they are going to be behind other kids.
And even as this industry has been making big educational claims, it's been making even bigger profits. Sales of infant videos and DVDs purporting to be educational are expected to reach $7.8 billion by 2010.
After her daughter was born, Julie Agner Clark searched for ways to share her love of music and art with her child. So she borrowed some equipment and began filming children's videos in her basement. The Baby Einstein Company was born, and in just 5 years, her business grew to more than $20 million in sales. Julie Agner Clark.
This is a billion-dollar industry that is a complete and total scam. There's no evidence that a baby watching a DVD is learning anything.
Educational videos aimed at babies may not be such a bright idea after all.
Oh, I come from a land, from a faraway place where a caravan camels roam.
The lyrics of Aladdin's opening song, Arabian Nights, were written by Howard Ashman. He actually submitted two versions of the lyrics, and Disney chose the version which was considered racist by members of the Arab American community.
The song, you know, that goes, I come from a land, from a faraway place, where the caravan camels roam, where they cut off your ear if they don't like your face. It's barbaric, but hey, it's home. That song sets up the kind of people that live in Agrabah.
Oh, you must be hungry. Here you go.
You'd better be able to pay for that.
Pay?
No one steals from my cart.
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. I don't have any money.
Thief!
Oh, please. If you let me go to the palace, I can get some from the Sultan.
Do you know what the penalty is for stealing?
No, please.
The merchants are unfriendly. They're mischievous and brutal. One merchant tries to chop the hand of the princess because she takes an apple, which goes against Islam. In Islam, you are obliged to feed someone if they are hungry over and over again. And that's what devout Muslims do. That's what devout good merchants do. And only in Saudi Arabia, if you are a thief, a real thief, and after three warnings and three convictions, if you steal something, is the hand removed. In one country, with a population of a few million. And yet they opted to use that scene. It took us 6 months to get a meeting just to talk about the film.
When Arab Americans protested against derogatory stereotypes in Aladdin, their concerns were first met with silence. Disney responded after the issue had received widespread negative press coverage.
So we go to the corporate office in Burbank. And we sit there and maybe 15 minutes into the meeting, I won't mention the gentleman's name, but he accused us, the three of us, of drumming up negative publicity against the film. And it was only months after that meeting that they changed part of the lyric.
But Disney still kept the line, it's barbaric, but hey, it's home, which prompted the New York Times to write an op-ed piece saying, "It's racist, but hey, it's Disney."
I think the commercialization is probably the most appalling thing about the Disney movies. Because some of the movies, even if I don't like the whole show, and very often I think the show is overproduced, at least it's interesting, and there's some things I'd like the children to learn from that movie. But I see no reason why I have to go to Toys R Us and buy t-shirts that have the movie advertised on it, and why they have to have a backpack that says Lion King. And it offends me that I'm doing Disney's advertising and paying for the privilege.
The prevailing values of the commercial system provide no incentive to develop bonds with future generations. We don't care about the future. There's a real sense of nihilism and despair about the future, and a closing of ranks against the outside. At one time, it was thought by some people that the environmental crisis would be the linchpin for the lessening of international tensions. That as we recognize that we could only survive collectively together, then the world would come together to cooperate to save the Earth. Unfortunately, as the Persian Gulf War made clear, the new world order of the 21st century will be based on international conflict over increasingly scarce resources. As George Bush said, American troops are being dispatched to the Gulf to make possible our way of life that requires cheap oil. And if the cost of that is 100,000 dead Iraqis, well, so be it. Someone has to pay the cost so that we can keep driving our cars and using our appliances. The Gulf War is a review of what is to come. As the world runs out of resources, the most powerful military sources will use that might to ensure access. The Third World will simply be seen as enemies who are making unreasonable claims on our resources.
The radical right-wing militia movement can also be seen as the extreme wing of the men's rights movement, a backlash by men whose gender, racial, and sexual identities have been dramatically challenged over the past generation. Some men's violence against women can be seen as a response to women's increased assertions of their right to equality, with the violence being men's attempt to maintain the power and control they fear they're losing. We can see the rise in gay bashing as a direct result of the degree to which some men are panicked by a loosening up of the traditional strictures of manhood and an opening up of sexualities and different kinds of lifestyles among men. So we have to be vigilant to protect the gains of the past generation, but we also have to move forward and offer boys a more positive set of alternatives. Instituting these changes will take a lot of courage, and more intelligence, in fact, than is required for putting on the tough guys. If we wanted to see what's at stake, it's provided in the film Good Will Hunting, which I think is a really important film.
Unless you want to talk about you, who you are, then I'm fascinated. I'm in. But you don't want to do that, do you, sport? You're terrified of what you might say.
I think the reason that millions of American boys and men could identify with the Matt Damon character was that they could see themselves in him. That the hurts he had suffered, the physical abuse, the loneliness he felt growing up as an orphan, had caused him to put up this really defensive shield. So that he had all this bottled up rage that was expressed as anger and violence through the course of the film.
Don't bullshit me! Don't you bullshit me!
It's not your fault.
With me, all right? Don't be sure, not you.
It's not your fault.
So when Robin Williams, as his therapist, is telling him that it's not his fault, it takes real courage and character for him to give up the tough guys and admit that he's vulnerable and needs other people. The reason why I think Good Will Hunting is such an important film is that it's a metaphor for the idea that it's a lot easier to put on the act, the tough guys, than it is to do the real hard work of looking inward, both as individuals and as a society. Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., and Nelson Mandela. They all represented peoples who had suffered incredible violence and bloodshed at the hands of brutal oppressors. But instead of responding with violence, they responded, at key moments, with peace and reconciliation. And it took a lot more guts to do that than the far easier path of violence. All of this is going to take a lot of work, and it's not going to happen with just individual boys and men being more reflective about their choices. It's going to have to happen both on a personal and on an institutional level. Everyone has a role to play here, and not just men.
While girls and women are not responsible for men's violence, they too have an important role to play, because the tough guys is attractive to men in part because they see many girls and women validating it. Girls and women have to show that they're looking for more in men than bad boy posturing, and in particular, that they value men who reject the tough guys.
Disney and Disney products and movies is having a big influence on children's play. It's part of the whole move in media to market toys to children through movies, TV shows, video games. The problem with marketing to children and having toys that are highly realistic replicas of what children have seen on the screen is that in many ways it affects how they play.
Play is natural for children, comes natural. And through play, children get to know themselves, get to know the world around them. It's a chance to explore, to create their own means of exploring the world. They develop imagination, language, skills, social skills. If you tell the child how to play, you are depriving the child of what's maybe necessary for that child's development.
When children see a movie and then try to replicate the script, and their toys that help them do that, a whole line of toys that are exact replicas of what they've seen on the screen, the message they're getting is, kids, when you play, you're supposed to play the movie, and here are toys to help you do it. And because children focus on the salient dramatic, the toy keeps them focused on that narrow plot. And when I hear a lot of my research has had been teachers describing play all over the world looking exactly the same. And it can stay the same and fixated and not evolve and change. When that happens, children learn the lessons they see in the media much more than they otherwise would when their play is just a replica of what they've seen on the screen.
As a teacher, I get to see the impact magnified. You know, it is very clear when you go into a school and there's a movie about to be released, and slowly but surely all children start coming in with all the products that are advertising this movie.
The marketing to children is not just done through the ads that they see. It's also the program itself or the movie itself. The whole production is used as a way to sell products, and where it reached a new peak in a movie like Hercules. Their urns with the Hercules symbol and mugs and sneakers, and it's a total anachronism in that it doesn't really relate to the times of Hercules at all, but it's showing children shopping and getting all the products and all the excitement of the products. So it kind of makes this kind of seamless marketing between the show and the ad totally undistinguishable for children.
It's extremely powerful, and no, you cannot escape it as a parent. I think that you would have to, I can't imagine, lock your child in a house and not let them go out. You know, it's impossible. It's everywhere.
You can't get away anywhere you go from the products that are being sold. And they overlap. So that if Disney produces a bad film, it doesn't have to worry. Because you see, it owns a television station, or it owns a television network, in which it can run that film over and over again to massive audiences, right? Or it can use its retailers to, in fact, transform it into a video and sell it in its video stores. Or it can market it abroad. Or it can create a whole new toy line. Or if we miss the point, it can begin to advertise it over and over in its newspapers, in its magazines, in its journals, so that eventually it will seem as if that really is such a wonderful product. How could it be in so many places? How could you miss it? I mean, so it seems to me it has the power to place that product. It has the power to turn every element of communication and information into an advertisement.
Now, coverage you can count on. This is News Center 5.
This
Despite below freezing temperatures, onlookers stood four deep for the 74th annual parade. The big news was the return of Mickey Mouse after an 18-year absence.
But this is also linked to a much, much bigger issue. And that bigger issue is, what kind of society do we want to live in? Do we want to live in a society where seven global corporations control our culture? At the moment, the only people at the table are the holders of corporate power. That's not a democracy.
We have no obligation to make history. We have no obligation to make art. We have no obligation to make a statement. To make money is our only objective.
I'm reminded here of the work of Antonio Gramsci, an Italian progressive who was fighting Mussolini's fascism between the wars. And the phrase he used, which I think describes our current situation, was pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. Pessimism of the intellect means recognizing the reality of our present circumstances, analyzing, properly understanding the vast forces arrayed against us, but insisting on the possibilities and the moral desirability of social change. That's the optimism of the will. Believing in human values that will be the inspiration for us to struggle for our survival. If we wanted an image of this, I think of that Chinese man who stood in the way of the tanks that were on their way to Tiananmen Square, taking a stand in the face of the most incredible adversity. And I think the question we all need to ask ourselves is, if we believe in the future, if we want to create a humane and peaceful world for generations to come, what stand are we willing to take?